The previously untouchable subject in Thailand. Angry protesters break the taboo by openly criticizing the king. They're also demanding wholesale changes to the political system. Is that possible? And why is the monarchy being targeted? This is Inside Story. Hello, welcome to the program. I'm Hashem Ahelbarra. They've been rallying almost daily for the past month. Anti-government protesters led by students are attracting different sectors of Thai society. Their main demand is a change of the entire political system. That includes the resignation of former army general, now Prime Minister Prayuth Chan-Ocha. One of the largest protests since the military seized power in the latest coup 6 years ago was held on Sunday, as well as changes to the constitution and to the intimidation of political activists. Some are calling for what has long been unthinkable, reform of the monarchy. Any criticism of the royal family is an offence that can lead to a long prison sentence. Our reporter Scott Heidler reports from a student rally held on Tuesday.
A new generation of protesters was born on university campuses and high schools right across Thailand here. They are out here because they don't believe this current government represents their needs and their future. Now, we've seen a string of peaceful protests over the last month. On Sunday at Democracy Monument here in central Bangkok, there were over 10,000 people, again, led by student groups, but there were a lot of other people who also joined them. Now, this is something that has been growing again peacefully for the last several weeks. Again, the main message these students are saying is they don't believe that the government represents them.
A new progressive society for students, or just as like a country that needs to move forward. So I think that's our stance, that like we can't be oppressed anymore. We can't be under a regime that does not care for its people.
I think there are inequalities in Thai society. We can't live like this anymore. We should take a stand for ourselves, for our generation and the next generation.
These students gathering here at Mahidan University. Now, the overall student-led movement has some demands. They are looking for a change in the constitution, a rewriting of the constitution that was drafted by the military government. They want a new government, they want new elections, and also they are proposing an overhaul of the monarchy. Now, that's very dangerous territory here in Thailand. The monarchy is something that is very revered by most of the population here, but this is a step that this movement has taken that hasn't been seen in a very long time, so it's dangerous territory. They've gotten warnings from the government, but they say if there's not reform in the government and work on a new constitution, again, they're going to get a lot of people out to the streets by the end of September.
Let's meet our guests in Bangkok. Pravid Rojanaprak, a political reporter and columnist for the Council of English News website. In Kangan, in northeast Thailand, David Streckfuss, a Thai historian and author of Truth on Trial in Thailand, Defamation, Treason, and Lese, Majeste. Also in the capital, Jade Donavanik, Dean of the Graduate School of Law at Siam University and former advisor to the Constitution Drafting Committee in Thailand. A warm welcome to you all. Pravit, how to best define the protest movement which is now gaining momentum in Thailand? Who are they and what's their agenda?
Well, basically, they are new generation of young Thais, really new. We're talking about people aged between, say, mostly 15 to 22, 23. They grew up under the military junta. See, Thailand had a military coup back in May 2014. Mm-hmm. So these people came of age under the military. And now, although we had in an election, but, you know, end up having the same person as Prime Minister, which is General Prayuth Chan-Ocha. These students, this youth, really want change, a different, more free, democratic, and equal Thailand. So they made demands, some less controversial, like they wanted a fresh general election, mm-hmm. drafting of a new constitution, which is not junta-sponsored as it is in case, you know, for the case of the current one, but as well as a reform proposal, 10-point reform proposals for the Thai monarchy institutions in order to have an institution, a monarchy, which is more strictly in line with what we see in the United Kingdom or in Australia, where people could debate freely about the issue.
David, is it fair to say that these are people who are basically anti-establishment, or are they mainly anti-military junta or precisely anti-monarchy?
I think they're anti-junta. Ever since this junta came into power, there's always been a question of legitimacy. And the 2016 referendum on the new constitution was not held fairly. And then it produced the 2017 constitution. And so whatever might get in the way of creating a more democratic Thailand or provide some sort of challenge is one of their targets. And primarily it's the military junta. But because of the long history of the relationship between the junta and the monarchy also has come under scrutiny.
Mm-hmm. Jade, is it safe to say that these are young people who are trying to build momentum across all the sections of society, or do you see them more of an isolated outcry against the establishment?
I don't think they are trying to isolate the establishment. And in the wake of new democracy that the youth are calling for, I think if they are attacking on the establishment as the junta, or the junta becomes an elected government by way of having a constitution, which Khun Prayuth also said that it's an unfair drafting of the constitution, that it's supported or sponsored by the junta. And what David was saying, that they are trying to look for some sort of reform for the establishment as a whole. And when they are looking beyond the establishment, then since we are democracy with king as head of state, they are looking beyond the junta, looking beyond the establishment, up to the king. So I don't think they are separating the two from each other.
Pravit, you've mentioned many issues which have been debated currently in Thailand, but I think the Lese Majeste law has shaped the national debate in Thailand, particularly among those young protesters who want the law to be scrapped. Do you see that potential being fulfilled in the near future?
It would be difficult, but look, the Lese Majeste law, if anything, has restricted, paralyzed a possibility for an open debate. As we speak, the mainstream mass media have hugely self-censored themselves. So the 10 demands are actually spreading through social media rather than through the mainstream mass media. We need to have a real deliberation, a talk, but the law is making it impossible. Nevertheless, the young, you know, demonstrators have really used social media to bypass the self-censorship of the mainstream mass media. Mm-hmm. So I think the debate will drag on and it will continue, but it won't be easy to see this law abolished or even amended, mm-hmm. although it's part of that demand.
Okay.
Well, I think let me say something here.
Go ahead.
When we are talking about Lese Majeste, I think we have to make a separation between three issues. I don't think there is anything like Lese Majeste. I think that the reporter, the journalist, or anyone who are pointing their finger towards the Section 112 of the Penal Code, mm-hmm. is just calling it Lese Majeste, whereas there's no Lese Majeste anymore in this era. It is defamation of the king. It is other things that is in line with other sort of defamation. However, it's only that the offense against His Majesty the King will be under imprisonment, which is higher than any other defamation. So first of all, when we call it Lese Majeste, there's no such thing. The second thing is that the law itself is to protect the head of state. And I'm sure in any country, there is a law to protect the head of state. So in this second point, is it the use of the law, the utilization of the law, or it's the law itself.
Mm-hmm.
And third, okay, yes, the 10 proposals may seem to be reasonable, but the preamble to it, if it's only the 10 issues that were proposed, I think that can be accepted, even in the mainstream media.
Well, I think
but
in this, David,
think
and,
about,
I'm sorry, I have
think
to,
about the preamble.
I have to
yeah,
step
think
in.
About the preamble.
I have to step in here and include David, because I think there are many people who would completely disagree with you about the fact that Lese Majeste law is there. And you can just look at the people who have been sent to prison just for expressing criticism for the
the
king
or
the
saying about the second point
monarchical system. And this is why I'm asking David this question: is this is this an attempt by the people to say we need the monarchy itself to reinvent itself or to reform?
The Lese Majeste law, or whatever you want to call it, defamation of the king, queen, heir apparent, or regent, serves as a linchpin to hold together an ideological edifice that the military has used for decades, and especially since 2006, to suppress any sort of discussion, whether it's about the personal life of the king, or whether it's questioning whether the royal budget should be open to scrutiny, whether the financial position of the king should be under debate, and so it's in a way, Ajahn here is correct, because it's more than a Lese Majeste law. It's been used as a tool to suppress any sort of opposition. What happened lately, though, is that the new king ordered the attorney general not to pursue any new cases.
Mm-hmm.
And so for a while, until a couple weeks ago, it hadn't been invoked. I mean, there were other laws that could silence critics.
Mm-hmm.
And that, in fact, that was happening in June. The prime minister reiterated what the king had said, and that opened the door, it seemed, to a larger critique of the monarchy and its role within Thai society.
Mm-hmm. Pravit, is it the erratic behavior of the monarch, his long absence? Is it the fact that there is a growing momentum in the country saying it's about time to prevent the military establishment from using the law itself to further clamp down on discontent?
You know what? The irony being that I can't even answer the questions you ask without risking of breaking the law. And you know what? This program, as I understand, is live. Probably is not being carried, by the Thai cable television network. It's being censored. Over the past week, we have seen Al Jazeera and a few other channels being censored locally here in Thailand. So I'm not at a liberty to give you a straight answer, but let me just put it this way.
Sure, please.
There's
go
a
ahead.
Lot of questions. There are a lot of questions about the monarchy institution that cannot be answered, that cannot be publicly debated without the risk of one's
I see
safety
your point.
Or freedom. And that's a problem with
fair enough. So let me put it this way. Do you think that some of the criticism is an attempt by the young protesters to say to the military establishment, stop using the law to clamp down on dissent?
Yes, and that's just part of it. They want a freer, more equal society where, talking about anything under the sun, as long as you don't defame someone, in this case, the king, should be permissible and should be a basic right. Like in the United Kingdom, people debate whether they should have the monarchy after Queen Elizabeth II is gone or not. Like Australia, they talk about the same thing. Should the Queen be the head of state, or should there be a monarchy as the head of state of Australia after Queen Elizabeth II is gone?
Mm-hmm.
We can't even do that in Thailand. And actually, what the students and the youth are calling are very mild. They want a monarchy which strictly operates under the Thai constitution.
Mm-hmm. Jade, now, could this debate be conducive to real changes, like in the constitution, or could it pave the way for the military establishment that has been entrenched in the country over the last decades to play more of a restricted role in the country?
I think this is debatable, especially when, you see, when I pointed the three issues out. Mm-hmm. I think, okay, the law itself is one thing. Okay. The second thing is the use. I pretty much agree that many times the military or any establishment had been using Section 112 as well as Section 116 of the Penal Code in pretty much a wrong way. That I can agree with. However, in the third point, if you are attacking the establishment and you want the establishment change, or you want the military to be in line with the Constitution and to see what actually His Majesty, our current King, was saying, that do not use Section 112 with people. Okay. But we have to accept that even for commoners, even for other people on the walk of life, if someone is defaming such person, insulting such person, feuding such person, it's also wrong under the law. I think we have to accept this. If we accept this and you feel that Section 112 is posing too high an offense, too high an imprisonment on people, for example, up to 7 years is too much. How many years do you think it should be compared with ordinary defamation? Ordinary defamation, up to 2 years. Do you think up to 3 years, up to 4 years, if someone is doing that to head of state as the king, is mm-hmm. that enough? Then if we're talking about the law, and in that sense, we can accept it. Then on the second prong is that it has been used wrongly. If we want to make this right, I think this is doable and this can be talked out. Okay. The last issue I want to point out is that ever since 1932, the king, King Rama VII, is also attacked by the military. You can't forget that the movement in 1932 consisting of the civilian and the military. So I think His Majesty the King, King Rama VII, as well as the 8th, the 9th, also had some problems as well with the military. And every time that the military staged a coup, it's not only against the government, mm-hmm. it's against the people and also against the king. All so right. I think in this wake of new democracy, you also have to look at the king as part of being victimized. And then you will see the picture, who is actually to be reformed.
I see your point.
Is it the monarch or is it the military?
Let's go to David. David, having listened to all of you, don't you think that the pro-democracy movement or the protesters are picking the issue that could backfire, given the fact that the society itself is very religious, they consider the king to be sacred, and for them to move forward or to debate or to ask for a reform of the monarchy could backfire?
Well, I think the enthrallment that surrounded the monarchy has largely broken away. A process that didn't start yesterday or earlier this year, but started maybe 2006, 2007, 2008. And since that time, there's been more criticism. It's been in the semi-public sphere of social media and not in such a big way as in front of a protest at Thomas Eye University, where it happened the other day. But they're right now, everyone is forced to show loyalty, to show love to the monarchy, and that it has to be forced, and that you can go to jail for 15 years for each count against the monarchy, not against his personal person, but even just questioning the system itself, mm-hmm. Makes it very hard to know just how many people are still under the enthrallment. Okay, let's say there's millions, but there's millions others who aren't. And they are suffering under a persistent and sometimes radical authoritarianism. Mm-hmm. And they too need to be able to be part of that discussion.
Okay. Pravit, do you think that a change would be possible in the near future without the bureaucracy, the business community that have historically been aligned with the status quo?
It will be difficult. The students, the youth, will have to convince the largest, you know, groups of Thai, other sectors to join hand. But the time has come, and I think they, the adults, should listen to the youth very carefully, to their aspirations. They don't want to live in a climate of fear. Just to add to what David have just said, just recently, about less than 2 months ago, a man who kept on wearing a T-shirt saying he has lost faith in the monarchy has been taken into a psychiatric hospital for over a week. Think about that and what that reminds you. Mm-hmm. The young don't want to live in this climate of fear. Whether it comes sooner or later, I don't know, but I could see a change in the attitudes of this young generations, okay. And I don't think there's any going back.
All right. Jade, what's next for the military junta if the anti-establishment momentum, anti-junta momentum is gaining ground in the country?
Well, I think in the last point that Prabhupada as well as David have been making, I think it hits upon the actual point that there has to be change to the way in which the military is trying to control the country. Okay, and I think this will be the benefit as well as the positive side of this movement by the youth, that if they are attacking on the right problem, that the military is doing all these things to the country, not for the whole benefit of the country and not even for the benefit of the monarch. So I think if this is the point, then we will come to the same ground that we can talk, that Section 112 or whatever you call it, defamation, insulting, fielding of the king, or anything less majestic, has been used wrongly. Now we will have to come to the time and era in which people can talk. Things like Prayuth was presenting, if it is talked about or if it is presented in a polite way, in which a culture like Thai culture, and this you of course can compare with the United Kingdom somehow, but you have to also put the culture, the history of Thailand together.
Right.
Okay, and then this can be made and this can be talked about.
All right. And this is going to be my last question to David. David, this is a country whose history has been marked by violence, military coups, and constant attempts by the military junta to further consolidate its grip on power. Now, when you look at the future, you see the irony here, which is a youth which sees the establishment as anachronistic with the future. At the same time, the establishment holds power. Do you see the potential for a consensus, the potential for a political debate?
I think it depends on the strength of the students' movement and their ability to engage or bring out a faction within the Bangkok elite that will port having that dialogue. On their own, they will be accused of being treasonous. They'll be accused of being anti-monarchy. They'll be accused of this and that. Whereas their real goal is what kind of discussion needs to take place in order for Thailand to be more democratic, and that can't happen under the present circumstances or even under the current constitution. It doesn't allow for that kind of discussion that Thailand has long, long, long awaited for. Mm-hmm. And so it's possible that the Lese Majeste law may stay in place. It's in every monarchy except for Japan. So, but there could be conditions on how it's restricted and how it can't be used by other parties to suppress criticism. But the other things that they're talking about has to do with, like, treating the monarchy as a public institution is open to scrutiny.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll have to leave it there. David Streckfuss, Pravit, Rojana Prak and Jay Donavanik, it was a pleasure listening to your insight. And thank you too for watching. You can see the program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. For further discussion, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. Our handle is @AJInsideStory. From me, Hashem Ahelbarra, and the whole team here in Doha, bye for now.